Listening Library presents The Dreamatics by Michelle Cuevas. Read for you by Megan Hilty. For Indy, my dream dog. Cast list: Dreamatis, Personae. Luna, a dreamer. Matthias and Ted, her parents. Murph, a beloved dog. Dormir, a lowly theater assistant. The director. Circadia, lighting department. Knox, set designer. Tuck, costumes. Dozer, a handyman. Reverie, an actress. The 40 Winks Orchestra. Winks, conductor. The unseen playwright. The bad dreams. Coco, the worst. Grief, a poet. The counting sheep. The memory vault keepers. The questling beast. Prologue. On stage, a dream is unfolding. The theater's lighting department has outdone itself, somehow managing to perfectly recreate the amber glow of a late afternoon sun, right down to the dappled and dancing light through the leaves. The set builders have grown giant sunflowers that tower on the stage, and the actors have transformed themselves into dragon-sized bumblebees, emerging from the flowers with their fuzzy bodies covered in golden pollen. Even the air in the theater feels crisp and edged with the smell of apples. A great wind starts blowing, and yellow leaves begin swirling around the stage, some blowing out into the theater and over the velvet-covered seats. The leaves change to snow, and the stage is transformed. Now a lone lantern glows through the fluffy flakes. The ground sparkles like a million tiny moons, and the air smells of nutmeg, gingerbread, and a hint of pine. This is the magic of the theater. The way the creaking floorboards seem to speak in their own language. The way every prop, light, and velvet seat seem to know the audience by name. The way a stage can also be bumblebees and lanterns, cinnamon and snow.
This is where dreams are written, says the creaking floor.
This is where dreams are born, built, brought to life, say the blinking lights.
This is the Lunarian Grand. But then the sweet smells begin to sour, and the big, beautiful flakes of snow begin to whip in the wind, turning to hail, then lashing sleet. The theater goes cold, colder than cold, causing icicles to form below the box seats and balcony.
Crunch, crunch, crunch.
Something is stalking through the snow. Something is crushing fallen branches. Something is howling with a cry like screeching tires. The footsteps come closer and closer, carrying something wrong, something bad, something that smells of fear and darkness, and something worse, far worse, too awful to even imagine.
Cut! Yells the director. Wake up! Wake up! Wake up!
Join in the rest of the cast and crew. Wake up, I whisper, less sure than the rest. Wake up. It's only a dream. A brief explanation of the prologue. Only a dream, you're probably saying? Was that whole prologue just a dream? But I hate when writers do that. It's lazy. Just stay in reality, pal. Don't worry, I totally agree. Lazy, lazy, lazy. Well, that is, except in this one specific, very particular case. Because, you see, dreams are our reality. Hey, come back! Where are you going? Okay, I can see I'm starting to lose you. How to explain? Let's see. Have you ever woken up from a dream and thought, what was that? My Auntie Gertrude shaped like a giant platypus waddling through my middle school while singing the word farfanoogle over and over? Well, that dream, that was us. Or a dream theater just like us. We built the middle school set,
One of our actors played Aunt Gertrude the platypus, and our orchestra performed the Farfanoogle waltz in Z minor. That's because we are the members of the Lunarian Grand Theater, affectionately referred to among ourselves as the Dreamatics. Every night, we perform the dreams of one Luna Grande, age 10 and 3/4. Well, every night until tragedy struck and changed everything forever. But I'm getting ahead of myself. Let's start at the beginning. Chapter 1, The Weather Closet. Someone hadn't fully closed a jar of winter in the weather closet, and everything was covered in drifts of snow. Again. Frost glazed the bottles of wind and the jugs of raining rain, and I had to dig to find the glass orbs of sunsets I'd been sent for in the first place. I finally found the one that Knox had told me to find. Colored peach pie with clouds a la mode, fading into a melted sherbet horizon.
Team, your desire for a snowball fight later, said the director, is not an excuse to leave winter open in the set department again and give, whosamacallit here, frostbite.
I smiled and shook the snowflakes from my overalls. Sure, call me whosamacallit, or what's-her-name, or so-and-so. I answered to them all. Who needs to learn the name of the lowliest of low assistants? It's Dormir, by the way. My name, that is.
Sorry, boss, said Knox, our set designer. My bad. Also, you said you wanted to change the snow for tonight's performance? What kind of snow do you want?
Ugh, must I do everything? Asked the director. Just make it romantic. Make it fun.
She was wearing one of her usual stress-related t-shirts, which always featured things like a picture of a light bulb saying, I'm burnt out, or a head of lettuce saying, romaine calm. Today was another classic, a cat shouting, don't stress me out.
We've got all the kinds of snowy precipitation, continued Knox. Ice pellets, blizzard, squall, thundersnow.
Do you think thundersnow sounds romantic? Asked the director.
I wouldn't know, said Knox, putting her dirty work gloves on her hips.
Something unique, continued the director. Something poetic.
Unique, poetic. Well, we have one thing, fairly rare, said Knox. It's called watermelon snow.
And that is?
It's technically caused by a red-colored green algae called Chlamydomonas nivalis, said Knox with the poetry of a snowplow.
The director stared, bewildered.
It's pink, said Knox. Pink snow. It happens in the real world.
I didn't hear the end of the conversation, as I had plenty of my own work to do before the theater opened for the night. Not that I was complaining. I may have been a lowly low assistant, but I was lowly low at the Lunarian Grand, which was, in my humble opinion, the most majestic, magical, beautiful theater in the entire universe. I was sawing, nailing, painting, and rigging most of the time, sure, but I was also part of the show. I felt the tingling excitement every time the house lights dimmed, knew every line by heart, and whispered them under my breath from the wings, loving every moment, but knowing that I would never be in the spotlight. You will never bask in that kind of glow, I'd tell myself. You will never capture moments, say things unsaid, stir hearts, feel the thrill of the unknown. You will always be only what you are, a lowly stagehand, a set painter, an assistant to all, but never the star. Still, I thought, still, even a dream like me was allowed to dream.
Chapter 2, The Lunarian Grand.
If it isn't the Wizardess of Illumination, I said to my best friend Circadia, opening the door to the lighting department. Need anything before the show? Circadia, her giant eyes magnified even more by thick glasses, looked up from her table of various shaped light bulbs. She had a giant insect genius who may accidentally demolish the theater vibe about her.
Dormir, she said, check it out.
Which one? I asked, my eyes traveling around the room. Every shelf, every wall, and most of the ceiling were covered with lamps, sconces, chandeliers, and lanterns. There was an acorn lamp that made the entire theater fill with giant shadows of trees, a bat light that made stalactites appear on the ceiling and balcony, and an orb pendant filled with...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.